What's going on, you loyal listeners? Thank you for tuning in to the L Squared Podcast. I'm your host here, Luke Larson. And, you know, unfortunately, Old Legs is absent today. He will not be assisting me in leisurely launching you into levity, but we have an even special guest. You know, we know you guys have been clamoring for it. We've been trying for it. This might be my new co-host for the show. You know, I've heard your guys' complaints. Look, you don't have to deal with Old Legs every day. I do, and it's a living nightmare. But I'm very happy to introduce my very special guest. We met at the South Dakota Film Festival. His film, The Eighth Commandment, played there. Writer-director Joshua Olson.
Hey, what's happening? Luke, how are you, man? I'm happy to be here. You know, I don't deal with Old Legs every day, so I am kind of sad that he's not here, but you seem very stoked about it, so yeah. I'm happy to talk to a happy Luke Larson.
That's right. That's the best Luke you're going to get. I just feel, you know, when he's not around, I just have so much more energy. You know, life just seems to have more meaning, and it's a lot better. You know, Old Legs is, like, good for, like, a party trick, but it, you know, it gets old after a while.
That's good. Okay. All right. I understand. I'm beginning to fully understand the dynamic now.
Right. So, I mean, like, the little bit you met him, that's like the perfect amount. You'll never have to meet him again. And you'll have fond memories, and I'm happy for it. You know, if we could trade spots, I would. But, you know, so behind the curtain here for the loyal listeners, this is actually a redux interview.
Oh, it's part two.
It's part two. Yeah, it's
remake. Is it a reboot?
It's a little bit. It's a little bit like if we remade like, Jerry Lewis. Jerry Lewis's clown movie,
like the one that the clown who cried.
Or whatever.
Clown, I don't remember.
Yeah,
I think the
day the clown cried or something. Yeah, and no one's
Have
ever
seen that movie.
No, I don't. I didn't think it existed. I thought he destroyed every copy of it.
I imagine that it's like one of those things that you can find somewhere, but like, you know, you gotta know a guy who knows a guy,
right.
And it's like, always gonna be like, you'll see half of it, and then the VHS will cut out, and then it'll come back in like two-thirds of the way through.
Yeah.
Kind of one of those, like, super underground type experiences.
Like, you'd have to go on the dark web.
And I'm sure it's there somewhere.
It's got to be out there. I would love to see it. But then it's also like, it's almost better that I feel like it's better that no one knows about it, because then it has this mythos, you know.
It's called The Day the Clown Cried.
The Day the Clown Cried.
I'm almost positive that's the name, in case there was like somebody listening that was like, you fucking morons, how do you not know?
I hope so. I really hope there's a loyal listener out there that has that much knowledge about secret films and Jerry Lewis, I guess. But this episode is like if we were remaking Jerry Lewis, because the Day the Clown Cried, because, you know, that episode, things happen, but it's now a prisoner of the moment. It's never going to be released.
It's just for us,
our special moment. So now it's a little bit less special. You know, but that's okay. It's life.
Yeah, we're miles apart, and, you know, we've learned a lot. We've grown since the original.
Yeah, we've come a long way. Yeah, you know, I feel like we've changed a lot. We've had our character arcs. You know,
the listeners are really going to get us, you know, in the third act at our best selves.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. They're going to get us in as Return of the Jedi. You know, we have our black suits on. It's a little more form fitting. We made our own lightsabers. You know,
yes,
that was a Star Wars reference.
I like where we're going with the references. I think we could do this literally all day.
We could.
we're Return of the King form. Mm-hmm. We're like, you know,
yeah, just keep bouncing them back and forth. We'll just go through every. We'll make a reference to every movie ever made. But
and then everyone, every comment will be, where the fuck is old legs? Please bring him back.
This is why we need old legs. Otherwise, this will just keep going on forever. But one thing, this is my attempt at a segue in case you were keeping score here. But maybe one reason that you and I and old legs, I'll throw him in here even though he's not here. Maybe one reason we have this encyclopedic knowledge of film is because where we grew up, you know, we used it as an escape because we, you know, we're from a barren, cold landscape.
I wholeheartedly agree. I think that has definitely formed who I am as a filmmaker. I mean, I like had to, my parents didn't even let me watch a lot of movies, mostly for content reasons, being evangelical Christians. And so I like would get R-rated movies, like art films from the library, which the Sioux Falls Public Library is like, there's, you know, they have Oscar winner movies, but that's as far as the art film extends.
Sure.
And like hide them in my bedroom, watch them late at night, and like that is how I informed myself about cinema.
And that shows the commitment and the true love. And then it's like it's more special that way. You have a more intimate relationship with it. And for the loyal listeners out there, if you don't listen every episode, I'm from South Dakota, old legs from South Dakota, and Joshua Olson is also from South Dakota.
Yep, Midwest boys born and raised.
That's right. Corn fed. That's what people say.
They do. That's all we eat out there.
That's all we eat. Yeah, some of us, old legs and I, some of us just eat popcorn. We're popcorn fed. That's inside baseball. We don't need to get into that again. But I will say, you know, I was being the official podcast of the South Dakota Film Festival. We've been given permission to say it. We weren't sure if we were allowed to say it for a long time, but a different Josh Koopman, gave us the approval. I don't know if he was approved to give us approval, but I'm going to take it. So we are now officially the official podcast of the South Dakota Film Festival. I was excited that when you reached out and wanted to do it, because I was like, this is going to be awesome. Like another film fan who's out there doing it. You know, you're out there, you're making magic, you know, and you're living the life. And I was stoked to see your film, and I was even more excited when it got done. I was like, that was fucking kick ass, man. It's so good.
I appreciate that. I really appreciate that, man. It's weird, you know. I mean, you spend a lot of time and money on something that, you know, really you only have your own intuition to go on of like, is this any good? Like, I like it, but, and, you know, and of course, you know, there's, in film especially, you have 1,001 collaborators even on a small project, and so, like, you know, you did get some validation along the way of, you know, that my head wasn't completely up my own ass, but it was really special, you know, having my first festival for the film be in South Dakota in my home state, and a pretty warm reception as far as things go. Especially for a film that says the C word multiple times.
Yeah. I mean, that definitely takes some balls, especially this is your first film, right? Your first short.
Yes. Yeah. This is my first, I've done a bunch of like sketches and shoestring budget projects and things like that along the way, just kind of to cut my teeth. Mm-hmm. But this is the first one that really, that I really put some weight behind and literally put my money where my mouth was.
Yeah.
So,
and you kicked the door in, man. I mean, it was awesome. And just like, so to give the premise of the film.
Sure.
Luckily, you know, I have this sentence typed out, so I don't have to, you know, try and patch one together. But during the attempted robbery of a Catholic church, one crook finds more value in her own personal freedom than in anything she can take from the parish.
That's, you have no idea how long it takes to craft a log line. Or maybe you do. I don't know if you've tried, but it is one of the most horrendous parts and one of the most undersold parts of creating your own film is that you have to boil all of your ideas, not only into a 10-minute film, because they say that over 10 minutes is even tough to play festivals, and then you have to take that 10 minutes and boil it down into a small, sexy sentence that podcast hosts across the U.S. and South Dakota can keep That's their eye on and read on their podcast.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I appreciate it. Thank you for that.
No problem. I'm glad it works for you.
It does very well. Makes my job way easier than it already is. But, you know, I wish you had done work on, you know, we did an episode, one of my favorite episodes, where we sat down and talked about every single one of the 8 Leprechaun movies that have been made in that franchise. Yep, it's a 2-hour episode. Check it out.
Did you watch them all in preparation for the episode, or had you, like, were you grabbing collective memories?
No, I wish that would have been much easier. We were like, hey, St. Paddy's Day is coming up. What should we do? Our producer, quote unquote, Josh, was like, oh, you guys could watch, like, the Leprechaun movies and do episodes. I was like, oh, yeah, that'd be fun. There's got to be, like, what, 3, maybe 4? And we looked, and, like, Old Legs, like, oh, no, there's 5. Well, no, there's 6, too. Oh, 7. No, there's 8. I thought he was messing with me. I was like, there's no way they made 8 of them. Sure enough. And so over the course of 2 days, that's all I did. And Old Legs, we just watched all of them. And then we went in depth and talked about them in order. And, you know, it's a badge of honor. But one of the things we talked about in the episode was that the log lines for those were great. They all had something to do with gold or luck. Like, their luck runs out. And it was pretty bad. But then, like, they would give up. Like, some of them wouldn't have a log line. And then they'd come back and one would and whatever. That was a way for me to use a segue to promote a previous episode of my own show. So thanks for letting me do that.
Hey, there you go. No problem. Hey, shameless plugs. That's what it's all about.
That is what it's all about.
In this game that we're in.
But I really can't. I can't say. I just watched your film again right before we did this. And
thank you. I appreciate that.
And I honestly, I'm not just saying that. I'm probably gonna watch it a bunch more times. Just I really like it, and I love. There's so many things. Like, it opens with just this, boom, instantly awesome music. I was like, all right, this is cool. And
Thank you. That's a really cool band. That's a fun little story. The band is called the Dirty Shakes. I don't believe they're performing together anymore. But I actually got that CD on a catering gig from someone who I was working with, like, first months in L.A. And he's like, hey, let me give you the CD, you know, this is my band. And I tried to pitch a music video idea to them, and they didn't really have funding, and I couldn't fund the project at the time, and just kind of stayed in touch with him over time. And when this film came around, wanted to use one of those songs, and that one worked well. It's actually kind of about, like, a Bonnie and Clyde type relationship, so it works well for the film as well. It was just, there was so many little moments like that throughout the making of this short that, like, seemed, you know, not to be too blasphemous, but seemed like divine providence in a way.
I was just going to say, we can get as blasphemous as we want, you know, I'm all cool with that. No, but it's like, I mean, that's gotta be validating in and of itself, just like when you're trying to get this to happen and you're the one putting everything together. And like you said, it's, you put your money where your mouth is. And I would think little moments like that really would validate it and just be like, oh, like, this is special. Like, this is meant to happen this way.
It does. It gives you that feeling of to push it forward and push it through all the, like, oh, I don't know where to find anyone to do this for this price, or I don't know how to tie this all together, or where, how I'm going to get it colored, or whatever the challenge seems to be. There was always a little bit of fuel on the fire of, like, something that did come through, or a crew member that lined up perfectly, or, you know, all those little things. And, And it's really cool. I think that's kind of what makes filmmaking so singular as an art form, and makes it something that I want to do the rest of my life.
Yeah.
Is just the way that the collaboration happens and things just fall into place when they need to.
Yeah. And I never get sick of hearing those stories. Like there's this book out there called, speaking of Star Wars again, it's called, man, I just totally blanked on the name. I think it's like something like How Star Wars Conquered the Universe. That's what it's called. By Chris Myers, okay. I think. But it's
same listener is just screaming at their podcast right same now. Same exact like, oh my one. God, I know the
can't
author.
Believe he did it. But it's a really fantastic book, and it the premise of it is interesting. But it was basically the idea for the book is like, how did Star Wars get to be Star Wars? How did it become this huge, iconic thing when it's like it started as this weird little space, whatever, you know, like, and it was like, yeah, I guess it's just always been such a huge part of the world and especially my life, like, how did it get to that point? And it's a very good read, but my favorite parts of that book were in the 70s when they were just trying to get this movie made, and Francis Ford Coppola had a big role to play in it. You know, he was hot at the time, and he was like bullying executives around for George Lucas trying to get it made, and then just people on the crew being like, this is going to flop, this is going to be such a weird dumb movie, like, what, you know? And it was just like all the little collaborations that went into it. It's like I can never hear enough about those stories, and in your case, that collaboration came together and it produced a really great piece of work. And I can't get over the fact that like just every frame of it, I can clearly see how much care was put into it, and just like all the shots are great. I love all the shots. They're framed well. They're lit extremely well. It's just the blocking. Every little thing about it, I really appreciated it. And I just kudos to you and to your whole crew, because I mean I really love it.
Thank you, man. That means a lot. I mean, like, it was very, you know, like I said, it was very special seeing it on the big screen for the first time, and it felt, you know, this was not something I expected, and I don't want to toot my own horn really too much, and I honestly don't feel like I am, because this came completely out of left field for me, but seeing it on the big screen, it felt in a way like it wanted to be up there, and that was like, you know, as a little film nerd watching DVDs and like hiding DVDs from my parents in my basement as a kid, like that was like the whole reason you do the thing and you take the risks and all that and you go on the journey. So it was really special, and I hope it gets to play a few more festivals and gets around a little bit and gets in front of audiences, because that's really the only reason that you make the thing.
Right.
So I'm glad that it's working for you, man.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, when you said that you grew up with parents that you had to hide DVDs from, and I read that you grew up in the church. I mean, what kind of inspiration did that draw you to this story?
Well, it's kind of why it stuck with me. I've always liked things that were a little bit, that pushed the envelope in some sort of way. And the easiest way to push the envelope is to go after something established, like a major religion. Mm-hmm. Because usually you find that the people who support it are happy to support it, and the people who don't are happy to usually be generally quiet about it, because they know the strength of the thing itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why it stuck with me. It was actually a story that a roommate of mine wrote in college, and so that makes it about 4 years between when I originally read the script and then rewrote it and made the short. And he's cool with that, by the way. We're very good friends. He did the music for the film. Awesome. So don't go around stealing people's ideas, kids. I didn't do that, and neither should you. But it, you know, it ch- changed a lot by the time I rewrote it and got to production, but the idea of these two crooks alone in a church with a priest, especially the idea of a guy in a black ski mask, all black for a robbery, across the confessional from a priest who is also in all black, mm-hmm. albeit without a mask. Just little visual things like that really stuck with me, and made the idea kind of keep coming up, and made me want to stick with it and write it and rewrite it, and until it got to a point where I really felt comfortable, you know, asking other people to work on it and putting up, you know, finding the funds and putting up the funds to make it happen. So, I think growing up in the church, one thing that I do like about this film as well is it's not like a militant atheist made this film. There's no direct disrespect for the church. I'm not trying to tell people not to go to church. I'm not saying the church is dumb or stupid or that religion is wrong. There's really no opinion in the film about those kinds of issues, which I think a lot of films that deal with topics of religion or Christianity do feel like they have to have those opinions.
Yeah.
And I wanted to stay away from that. I wanted to, you know, poke a hole in the power of that establishment, but not, you know, not have an opinion on the validity or the value of it itself.
Yeah, and a lot of times, I mean, when you see that, it can work, but I feel like a lot of times it's like, all right, we get it. Like you're trying really hard to go out of your way to try and tear it down and show, no, I don't support this. But I mean, in this case, it's like, yeah, I mean, that doesn't even matter. Like, why would it have, it has nothing to do with the story at all, whether or not, like, which side of the fence they lay on, you know, and it makes it more true to life. And it, I think,
yeah. And I think I find in my viewing experience of usually when you find a movie that is very critical of, you know, and very one-sided, either for, you know, for religion or not, but especially when it's against an organized religion, is it usually feels like it's coming from an ideological perspective or a logical point, from someone who doesn't necessarily have the experience of being in that or knowing people who do frame their lives around an organized religion. And it comes off cold, and it's not what I like about movies. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't give depth or life to the characters in it. It, like you said, kind of comes off as like a, you know, somebody belaboring a point.
Right. And I mean, if I could just stop me if you don't want me to if I'm going too far, but here I like just watching the film, like some influences that I could see in there, and I'm not accusing you of anything because they're
my
influences
too. What these are.
But I'll run through them and see how many I hit on. I could see Tarantino. See Martin McDonagh. I could see the Coen brothers.
Now you're not taking notes from the first time.
I would never do that to you, Josh.
Okay, good.
What do you mean? This is all from my own natural feeling. I would never do that.
No, there was you're dead on, especially with Martin McDonagh. I mean, like, you know, I feel like I went to film school and I know how commonplace it is to be like, I'm inspired by Tarantino and the Coen brothers and Christopher Nolan, and like, and not taking anything away from any of those guys.
But we all are. I mean, everyone
is. They're amazing.
They're rock stars.
Yeah, they're amazing, and they're the generation of film that we grew up with.
Yeah.
I mean, they're the best. They're the top of the bill working right now.
Yeah.
Especially that we're releasing films in our most formative period of teenage and later childhood and adolescence.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
those movies were huge. Mm-hmm. And so, but Martin McDonagh was one that was like very, it was a little, it came along a little bit later in my life. I knew some of his plays in high school. That one was that and Irish cinema in general. There was a version of this film that was going to be very inspired, heavily inspired by Irish cinema, where like everyone had Irish accents and was like really. It was going to be it. The reason it didn't end up that way is because it felt like a parody or like a film school project trying to be an Irish film. And
wait, you're
only 1/4 Irish. And you wouldn't even be able to tell from most of my family get-togethers.
So you were trying to make a 9th Leprechaun movie.
Hopefully they tap me when that comes around. I'll make sure that it's got a ball and log line, though.
Yes, please. And can I mean, this is too much to ask, but can I get a cameo? Just like one shot.
Luke Larson, if I direct, you can put this is going on audio. I want everyone to be able to remember it, who listens to the podcast. I want the producers of Leprechaun 9 to know when, or 10, you know, if I get tapped down the line for any Leprechaun sequel, you're going to be in it.
Woo!
I will say, I'll kill you in it if you
want.
Oh,
yes. Oh, that would be my dream.
All right, good. Well, we'll make it happen. Should I be tapped to direct the Leprechaun movie?
That's going
to
be in your contract. Like I have one stipulation. that's all I really needed. We can end it now if we want.
Hey,
I mean, that's
it's
all
your
I
podcast,
want.
Man. You call it when you want. If you want to end on the high note of that,
for my high note,
let's do it.
It's in verbal ink, so there's no going back. Now it's going to happen. The story is, I think it's relatable, and it's got layers, and it's fun, and it's funny, and it's actually, I would say even intense at moments, and you're able to capture, this is what really struck me when I watched it again today, was like, just how much tension you were able to capture in several moments throughout the film, while also being funny. And it's a tough balance to do, I'm just gonna keep shoveling compliments.
I appreciate it. Let me pop a few of your compliments, just in the sense of like, I really appreciate it, and those are all things that I was trying to do. I think, you know, going forward and in future films, I think there's definitely opportunities for me to like be more conscious of how like the timing and how those moments affect the overall piece. I think definitely, like, you know, I've showed this to a lot of people, just that I know from production work in LA, and I've gotten the whole gamut of feedback. I got to say, Luke Larson's is the most glowing, so I really appreciate that. It's tough. I mean, I know that I don't like stories with out and out villains, so it was difficult to make the villain someone that wasn't a complete terrible person that you were able to laugh at and with and sure. maybe even feel a little bit for up until the very end. And especially in 10 minutes, it's people are usually looking for something that knows exactly what it is and chooses a type very firmly, and that's not what I want to do when I'm able to direct something feature length. And I don't think very many feature length projects are good if they're only one thing.
Right.
And so that's, you know, that's what I'm trying to work up and practice as I make these short films that are, hopefully a proof for what I can do with a longer piece. Sure. And so I appreciate that. I'm really, really happy that, so many moments worked for you and you did find it funny. It was kind of fun listening to the crowd reaction throughout. you know, the South Dakota Film Festival Blue Hairs.
Right.
And the amount, just what they laughed at, and usually what they didn't, because there wasn't a lot of laughs. There was a few groans and gasps of shock towards the end. But but I got, you know, it was a really warm reception. It was a very fun experience to see it in front of an audience. But I'm glad that you found some laughs in there, because there are intended to be laughs. And I hoped it was funny.
Yeah.
I sure thought it was. But.
I thought it was great. And, you know, I mean, just, I don't know. Those blue hairs, whatever. I mean, that's honestly, like, that's better than getting a laugh sometimes if you can make blue hairs just turn in their seats.
Yeah, there was a couple, I don't remember when the priest tattles on him, or if it was at the kind of the penultimate gory moment, but I definitely heard someone go like, and I don't think any laugh or any other kind of reaction could have been as gratifying as that, like, expulsion of pure feeling. I don't think they even knew what they were feeling, but whatever it was very gratifying to me as a filmmaker.
So, I mean, this is an unfair question. So forgive me ahead of time.
That's all right. Let's be unfair. But, it's a fixed fight. You're the host.
That's right. You know what? I love this game because I'm in control. Where do you want to be in, 10 years? Like, where do you see yourself? However far along, however self indulgent you want to be.
Sure, sure. That's a good question, and it's one that I think about a lot, but I'm not asked to verbalize very often. So this is gonna walk the line of either completely being entirely full of myself or not giving myself enough credit. So
okay,
this
here
is
we go.
Great. I'm glad this is going to be on audio, because I'll probably have to listen back to it halfway through that 10-year span and be like, "Oh, how fucking wrong was I?" the goal at this point is just kind of to crank out a couple more short films, and I think in 10 years, you know, I'll be almost 37, so you can't really project any measure of success or anything like that. You can only, because it's all, you know, it's working hard, working very, very hard and staying with it, but it's so much luck and being in the right place at the right time, and so many things that you can't control that I hope I've at least made a feature film by that point. I look at it in the way of, I hope that I can be paid to be a director, within the next few years here, whether it's, you know, branded content or, television would be great. There's all kinds of new stuff in the digital space and streaming that's wide open for younger filmmakers. So I think making it my income would be a great goal in the next few. And I would hope that in 10 years, I'm able to be doing, basically be using someone else's money to do what I'm doing now on a larger scale.
Sure.
Like doing something that I really care about and that I think is really fun for an audience and really, really says who I am as a filmmaker, but, hopefully not going bankrupt to do it.
Right. Well, here, let me paint a picture for you. Ten years down the road, we have the South Dakota Film Festival. L Squared is there, the official podcast of the South Dakota Film Festival. In this world, I haven't progressed at all. I'm just in the same spot.
Wow. But, it's much darker for Luke Larson than for Joshua Olson. My God.
But
all
then,
right, all right, continue.
Featured guest, rolling out the red carpet, special guest Joshua Olson here to promote the world premiere of his first, or second, we'll say second, feature film, Leprechaun 10.
Oh, my God. World premiere. I love it. You should know, though, that, you know, well, no, all right. I was going to say, from my limited experience, which is just this year at the South Dakota Film Festival, I'm not sure how many people with the feature showed up. I guess some people did, right? The first, yeah, I guess the Thursday and Saturday. Yeah. It was just the Friday night screening where nobody showed up from that.
Yeah,
one,
so you want to be at the point where you can give the hi hat to the South Dakota Film Festival, where you're like, I don't have to go to that.
Yeah, that should have been my one sentence answer. Is yeah. I hope in 10 years I'm Hollywooding the fuck out of the South Dakota Film Festival. Just kidding, Diane and Tom. You guys are great. Please have me back. I love you guys. I know you listen to this because it's the official podcast of your film festival. You've done an excellent job curating it, and I was very happy to be there with the Eighth Commandment, and that is not disingenuous at all. I just like to be a dick.
Well, hey, it's all part of the show. You know, and I can't echo the sentiment enough. I like to put it out there as much as possible just to get the good vibes out. Because, I mean, Tom and Diane put on a great festival. It's a fantastic time every year. And it's the real sense of community that makes it what it is. And it's people actually, you have a great time because people give a shit. You know, they actually care about film. And they're there to, you know, support each other and be this real sense of community and culture and family, you know.
It is very exciting. It was much more taste oriented and tasteful than I ever expected a film festival in South Dakota to be. I mean, quite frankly, when they told me I was in, I thought I was going to be like the fringe of the festival, but no, they fucking went there
with some picks.
And not only that, but they also had a lot of really heartfelt and watch it, like just a watchable program through and through.
Absolutely.
And they do a great job supporting the kids who are still in college making films and who are just out of college, and people have been doing it for years, people who do it for work, do it as a hobby. Like they really do a good job, like you said, building the community. And it was a fun place to meet people who are as weird and passionate about film as I am.
Yeah.
So and quite a few that were weirder and more passionate about film than I am.
Exactly. That's almost the best part, where you're like, wow, there's someone who's farther down the road than I will ever be.
Oh yeah. You're like, oh wow, I definitely am not a cinephile. Yeah, never mind.
You're like, do I sound like that to other people? Is that what I sound like to normal people?
Yeah, wow. Exactly. When you explain your did we talk about your dog on the air or no? No,
we didn't.
No, that was off air.
But I mean, she's been brought up before.
I was going to do a callback to something that was that nobody would ever know about.
Then you know this show. No, that's right in line with the show. That's perfect. No, but so how can people follow this film? Because I want as many people to be able to experience it, obviously, as possible. So it's on its festival run right now, right?
Yes, yeah. We're submitted to, I don't know, probably a dozen festivals or so, hopefully doing some more soon here, and hopefully be actually screening at a few more in the next year. But it'll probably be on its festival run for most of 2020. The nice thing about short films, for anyone who may be listening who makes short films, you don't necessarily need to, you know, make sure you know where you want to submit and what their rules are, but a lot of places don't mind if you have it available online. So I'm looking into some things like Short of the Week and some different places to hopefully get it out so that people can go see it and hopefully enjoy it the way you have before it's all done with festivals. But right now we've got a Facebook page, which is the Eighth Commandment Film. And then our Instagram right now is slightly different and therefore very bad digital marketing, but it is just numeral 8th Commandment film.
Sure.
So it's Eighth Commandment film with the number, and the Facebook page has the in front of it. Can I use your platform to just talk shit on Facebook for a minute?
Sure, go for it.
So this film was originally called Holy Shit when I wrote it.
That's great.
And because it's a little bit, there's too many other things called Holy Shit. There's songs and other short films and all kinds of like different things called Holy Shit. And so I decided to change it for the release to the Eighth Commandment. And Facebook will not even take the South Dakota Film Festival's website as a legitimate reason for me to change the name of the page.
What?
From Holy Shit to the Eighth Commandment film.
Wow.
Somehow it violates their page stipulations and rules. No idea how. So if you go to @TheEighthCommandmentFilm on Facebook, it will say Holy Shit, but that is our page.
Wow.
And I don't... I think I might have said it wrong. I'm so bad at fucking digital marketing, dude. It's the worst. At the Eighth Commandment film on Facebook and @Eighth Commandment Film on Instagram. So go ahead and just play that back 7 to 8 times to figure out what the actual correct answer is, because I don't even know. But if you can give us a follow, if you can keep up with us, I'm trying to post as much as I can in between work and doing plenty of other things, for this film and for other projects. So we appreciate any kind of engagement at all on social media. But that's definitely where to find out first once the film is live and out there on the web somewhere.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, hey, go follow it at the Eighth Commandment, spelled out 8th on Facebook, at Eighth Commandment on Instagram, the number 8. Right?
You know, just go ahead and type all of it in the
just try every way possible until you
At it now. I pulled it up so that I can this is the final word. Facebook is @8 the Eighth Commandment film on Facebook with the numeral 8, and on Instagram it is the numeral 8 commandment film. So
there we go.
On Facebook, no the on Instagram, and the numeral for both.
Got it. Boom. Easy.
I'm sure you don't got it. I barely even got it. So
you gotta fake it till you make it.
Good luck to any listeners who actually have the good heart to try to support my goddamn short film.
Well, hey, I'm gonna type in every iteration I can to find it on there.
Good. I'm definitely going to hit you up with an angry email in like 4 hours if I don't see you following me everywhere.
I can't wait, man. Well, hey, thank you so much for coming on, man. I really appreciate it. I'm excited to follow you and your career and see where you go and follow this film and see people's, you know, reactions to it down the road.
Right back at you, Luke. I'm excited to have a new podcast to listen to on my many long drives in Los Angeles. So I'll keep up with you and Old Legs and maybe see you next year at the festival or see you around.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to where you guys take this to, and I appreciate you having me on both times.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks, man. And as always, you know, you can find me on Twitter @LukeLarson89. Find this podcast @L2Podcast on Facebook, @L2Podcast on Twitter, L2Podcast on Instagram. We're on SoundCloud. We're on YouTube. And check us out. So thanks again, Josh, so much for coming on. And until next time, peace. We'll be right back.